Good morning. Today I am going to take the class you on the instruments that is used in dactylocystorhinostomy operations. So first of all, you need to know that what is dactylocystorhinostomy operation. Now, as you all know, this dactylocystorhinostomy operation is done in chronic dactylocystitis patients. Now, what is done in that? It is nothing. What happens in chronic dactylocystitis, you know, is there is chronic inflammation of the lacrimal sac region, and as you know that a lacrimal this lacrimal sac is a part of our lacrimal apparatus. Now, what this lacrimal apparatus consists of? It consists of the canaliculi. That canaliculi opens into the conjunctiva through the puncta. So that canaliculi, both upper and lower canaliculi, that is present in both the upper and lower eyelids respectively, opens into a common canaliculi. That common canaliculi in turn opens into the lacrimal sac, and that lacrimal sac in turn opens into the nasolacrimal duct. This nasolacrimal duct becomes a connecting point between the lacrimal sac and the inferior meatus of the nose. So you can understand that the tear substance that is produced by the lacrimal gland is ultimately drained through this lacrimal apparatus into the inferior meatus by this lacrimal apparatus system. So any kind of blockage in this whole nasolacrimal in this whole lacrimal apparatus region can cause what is known as a kind of hyperlacrimation, a kind of epiphora. Okay, so the patient will complain that my eyes are always tearful. Okay, so what you need to do is that there is many causes of epiphora. Okay, so one of the main causes refractive errors. So first you should rule out the refractive error, and the next common cause is this. Some obstructions, a problem in this whole on this lacrimal apparatus pathway. So you need to exclude this pathway. For that, we do syringing. I don't know whether you had classes on syringing or not. Now, let me tell you something about the syringing, because after all, it is a part and parcel of this chronic dactylocystitis diagnosis. Okay, so first of all, what we do in syringing is that this is called, I think, is it visible? Yes, it is visible, I think. Yes, this is what is known as the punctum dilator. It is a straight instrument with sharp and pinpoint end. So what we do very carefully, first we instill some proparacin drop in the conjunctival sac, and then we dilate. This is known as, first of all, what is this instrument known as? It is known as punctum dilator. So we need to dilate the punctum first before doing the syringing. So as from the name you can understand what is punctum dilator. We instill this punctum, instrument into the punctum, the respective punctum, the respective canaliculi we are going to test, and we dilate that by instilling, putting into the punctum. This is a small holes that is present at the end of the canaliculi. So we dilate that with the sphunctum dilator. Okay, now after dilating the punctum, the respective punctum, we bring this cannula, that this is known as lacrimal cannula. Okay, another name is AC cannula, okay, antechamber cannula. It is used for a number of purpose. Okay, so one of the purpose is that is syringing. So this is the cannula, okay, only this part is the AC cannula. It is fitted with a 5 ml syringe or 10 ml syringe or 2 ml syringe as you wish. We draw some normal saline substance into this syringe and then we put this into that puncta which we have dilated, through that into the canaliculi. Okay, through that first the you will, by knowing the anatomy of the lacrimal apparatus, you will come to know that this canaliculi is, first it is vertical and then it is horizontal. So first we install it vertical and then we put it in horizontal. Okay, so normal saline is put here. First we install this AC cannula into that, through that puncta into the canaliculi, and inject a normal saline. Okay, as if we are inserting some artificial substance, artificial water instead of tear substance through that lacrimal apparatus to see whether there is any blockage or not. So what we come to know with this syringing, there are many possibilities. Either that this water will regurgitate through the same puncta through which we have instilled, through which we have done this syringing, or it will regurgitate through the opposite puncta. Okay, so what can be the conclusions drawn? Okay, and another one is that we ask the patient, after instilling this normal saline into the lacrimal apparatus, if the patient tells yes, some water is coming into his mouth or nose, then the whole lacrimal apparatus is okay. There is no blockage in anywhere. Okay, but if the normal saline doesn't goes into his mouth or into the nose, but it regurgitates from the same puncta, then what can be the possibility? That then there may be a same canalicular block. But if the water doesn't passes through the lacrimal apparatus into the nose or mouth and regurgitates to the opposite puncta and same puncta both, then there can be a possibility of either that the common canaliculi block is there, or there is some block in the nasolacrimal duct or lacrimal sac. So you need to differentiate in that case. Okay, if there is regurgitation from the same puncta, there is canaliculi, only that will be the possibility. But if it regurgitates from both puncta without any passage of water into the mouth or nose, then you have to think of the possibilities that whether that there may be a nasolacrimal duct obstruction, common canalicular obstruction, or lacrimal sac obstruction. So you need to differentiate between those. Okay, so for that we have another instrument known as lacrimal probe. Okay, so it is a straight, again it is a straight instrument, but you have blunt ends. Straight instrument, but you have blunt ends. Okay, so what we do is that we again put it into the puncta, into the common canaliculi, into the canaliculi, and we just move up till there is a hindrance. So if there is a soft stop, what we use? Soft stop. but it is stopped by some soft structures, then the possibility is that there is some common canalicular block or same canalicular block. Okay. But if there is a hard stop, that is some hard, if it is stopped by some hard structures, then that means that you are being stopped by some bony structures. That means it has readily entered through the canaliculi, common canaliculi, and it has entered into the lacrimal sac. Okay, so possibility is that the nasolacrimal duct is there is possibility of obstruction in the nasolacrimal duct region. Okay, now what is the significance of this? It signifies is that if you have a hard stop, that means there is nasolacrimal duct obstructions or so, only then you can do your dacrocystal rhinostomy operation. But if there is a soft stop, that is tissue obstruction, that is common canalicular block or so, there is no utility of doing chronic dacrocystal rhinostomy operation in that patient. So what is now dacrocystal rhinostomy operation? Okay, dacrocystal rhinostomy operation is nothing but we make an alternative. So what is the name of this? It is now named as lacrimal probe. Okay, so now next come to the thing that what is this dacrocystal rhinostomy operation? It is nothing but we are making alternative passage of flowing of the tears into the nasal cavity. Okay, why alternative passage? Because because it is done in the cases when nasolacrimal duct obstruction is found, so you need to make one alternative pathway. Okay, but in this case, this alternative pathway that we make, this pathway is the connection between the lacrimal sac and the middle meatus. Okay, have you understood? It means that in cases of the normal anatomical pathway of nasolacrimal duct, that goes into the inferior meatus. Okay, that opens into the inferior meatus. But in cases of dacrocystal rhinostomy operation, we make that alternate pathway not into the inferior meatus but directly to the middle meatus of the nose. So we make passage directly from the lacrimal sac to the middle meatus. How? It's nothing that we first open our lacrimal sac region. How it is done? We make one incision, skin incision, 8 millimeter away from the middle medial canthus, and make an incision, curved incision, and then we by dissection we notice the medial palpebral ligament. After we find the medial palpebral, we cut it off, just make a slit to expose my lacrimal sac, that is fundus region of the lacrimal sac, and then we dissect out that lacrimal sac slowly. Okay, so how do we dissect that lacrimal sac from my lacrimal sac from the lacrimal bone region? Okay, by this what is known as rouging. Okay, it almost looks like a periosteum elevator that is used in ortho department, but it is since it is used in is much smaller than that. So it has a chisel shaped appearance at the end. You can see, I think it is a chisel shaped appearance. Okay, so this is used to dissect the lacrimal sac from the lacrimal bone, and also not only the dissect from the lacrimal sac and the lacrimal bone, but also it helps, okay, to clear the lacrimal bone region. Okay, you have to clear the lacrimal bone region so that we can have a direct breakthrough of the lacrimal bone region, so we have a direct breakthrough into the bone and into the middle meatus. Okay, so this is known as rouging. what is it known as? Rugin. This rugin has another purpose also, let me tell you. I told you that we make the incision 8 millimeter away from the middle canthus of our eye. So this 2 rugin away, okay, it's not possible to measure all that 8 millimeter at all. We always make one thing that we measure by 2 rugin away from the medial canthus. Okay. Now, so we have dissected the lacrimal sac from the lacrimal bone. Okay. And then we dissect through and through into the into much more inferiorly up to the lamellar papyracea bone. It is like a paper thin bone, or what we call like as if like a paper like bone. Okay, so not very hard. It is a soft type bone. And then I don't have that instrument. I don't have that instrument. And then what we name, there is another instrument known as lacrimal curette. Okay, it is nothing but in the book you will find it is another straight type instrument with some scoop like thing at the end. Okay, known as lacrimal curette. Its one end is very sharp, another end you have the scoop like thing. Okay, by now with the scoop like thing we make a small puncture into the lamellar papyracea bone and make a direct entry into the middle meatus. Okay, then it's nothing, and make direct entry into the medial meatus, but still the hole is too small to make a direct connectivity into the medial meatus. What we do is that then we increase that bone hole by this instrument known as bone punch. Okay, bone punch, the hole that is already made, at the margin of that hole we put this punch and press and just lift it up and make a larger hole of that opening in the bone. Okay, so this is known as bone punch. Okay, and how much larger we make that hole is like your whole this finger should be easily put, okay, into the bone. Okay, so such a large hole you need to make. After making that hole into the bone, lacrimal bone, we make 2 flaps, okay, from both lacrimal sac as well as nasal mucosa. Okay, because after cutting the bone, what will you find? You find the nasal mucosa. So you need to make 2 flaps in each of the lacrimal sac as well as in the nasal mucosa. Okay, in the form of H-shaped flap. Okay, I think you can understand it. H-shaped flap. Okay, it's nothing but we one like what is H-shaped like this. This is it. But the this one flap, another is this like this. Okay. So you have one anterior flap, you have one posterior flap. Okay. In both this lacrimal sac as well as in the nasal mucosa. Then attach that anterior flap of the lacrimal sac with the nasal mucosa anterior flap and posterior flap of the lacrimal sac with the posterior flap of the nasal mucosa. Okay, and then we tie that flap with suture. What suture we use? We use 6-0 Vicryl suture. Okay, commonly used. And how do we suture? We suture with the with this instrument that is known as varicose needle holder. I think you had this instrument class in your cataract also. So we put suture with the help of this, okay, this needle holder. This is known as Barraquer's needle holder. Okay. Okay. And another one is the thing I have forgot to tell. This is what it is. It is known as tissue forceps. Okay. How will you know? This is tissue. We have other forceps also, like St. Martin's and all, but it is a larger tooth filler forceps, so that you can use it to hold tough tissues. Tough tissues matlab skin and all. The skin is primarily needed to hold in ophthalmology only in the cases of, not only in the cases, majority in the cases of the depth student. So you need to hold this. All the tissues were skin with this instrument, which have large tooth at the end. Okay, we have large tooth at the end. Okay, even need to know. This is known as tissue forceps. Okay. Now, another instrument is used in dactylostomy instrument operation. That is known as the Muller's retractor. What is known as the Muller's retractor? It is nothing. I don't have that instrument at the moment. You will find it in your book. It's nothing, but it helps to retract the tissues. And after I put my skin incision, initial skin incision for my lacrimal sac dissection or making holes in the bone, after opening my incision, we retract those tissues. Okay, we retract my skin and muscle tissues for proper exposure of the my lacrimal sac and the area around, so that I can make those flaps freely, bone holes freely. So that is a self-retaining tissue retractor, okay, known as a Muller's retractor. You will easily find it in your book. Okay. So bus is now all happened. You have made your flaps. Okay, in the lacrimal sac as well as the nasal mucosa, you have tied them up and you have made an alternative passage directly into your middle meatus from your conjunctival sac. Okay, how will we next? What we do next is nothing. Next, we tie up our muscles and skin. So, my dactylostomy anastomy operation is over. Now, before closing it all, we do a test again. We again do syringing after the operation. We again do syringing through the lacrimal cannula, AC cannula, through the lacrimal puncta and the canaliculi, and ask that whether the water is passing into his mouth or not. So if patient tells yes, it's passing, okay, then good. Your dactylostomy anastomy operation is successful. So it is all. Thank you.